Want to disturb you, Nydia?
Yeah. Are you by any chance going to be with us on Thursday for this?
I need to check my calendar, but it's likely, yes.
Good morning, everybody.
We're
going to get going here in a few minutes. If you could grab your plate, grab a seat, and we'll get it started. Alright guys, if y'all can start finding y'all seats, we have kind of a tight schedule here today. So our next congresswoman has an event in Tucker, so we want to try to get on a schedule here. Y'all heard of Karen Handel, right? Clap a little loud for the next one. Okay, well, cool. That's a good way to get people to the seats, isn't it? I'm going to go and turn it over to Angela. We'll go ahead and get the next one.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
How are y'all?
Great.
All right. Well, out of deference for our candidate who is on the trail and hitting the ground running, going all over the district today, why don't we recognize Karen Handel and let her rally the troops, because we've got a lot of work to do and we need all of y'all out campaigning this weekend, so please give it up for Karen Handel. Woo! All right, thank you so much. You know, I want to start off by saying thank you, because this is the first Fulton breakfast since the April 18th election, and I know I saw Bob Gray here. Let's give him a big round of applause. Thank you very much for making it a good competitive race. I was talking with someone that one of the big differences between Democrats and Republicans, they believe in coronations, we believe in competition, so I think that is right on. I was told by Roger Wise to do something first, and well, like most of you in the room, it makes me a little nervous not to do what Roger tells me, so I'm going to do it. So if this is a hat from President Trump, make America great again. Amen. I'm going to pull the number out, and Angelyn, I'm going to need your younger eyes over here to read the number.
I'll read the last four digits, 3310. 3310.
No one? Oh. Yeah. Oh, yeah, all right. No. All right, are we pulling another one? All right, one more. 3301. Is this a trick? Roger, are there any real numbers in here?
Just move it down. These numbers only started this morning.
Hey, Roger,
here we go.
Read it again. 3301.
3301.
All right.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you very much. All right, let's do a quick state of the race. First of all, folks, we are closing the enthusiasm gap. Wherever I go, Republicans are energized and ready to go. We know what is at stake on June 20th. This is a great crowd today, and I know how hard every one of you is working for me and for the Republican Party. And please know that I am working equally as hard to make sure that we do our jobs to bring home this election on June 20th. A couple of things to kind of go through. It's already been, whoever the they are out there, they have declared this race the most expensive race in the history of congressional races in the country. So we can expect anywhere from $40 million to $50 million to be spent on this race. I frankly find it obscene, but it is the playing field. And just know that from a money front, we are going to be just as competitive. Money is coming in great. It's kind of interesting that the little engine that could, the handle campaign, I now have a distinction at holding a fundraising record. The irony of that is not lost on me. But the most important thing is making sure that we execute flawlessly coming into June 20th. When does early voting start?
8:30 a.m.
Yes, yes. And we need to put as many votes in the bank in early voting as possible. We are now, at least in Fulton County, and I believe in DeKalb, I'm not sure about Cobb yet, there are going to be not one, but 2 days of Saturday voting. Look for our campaign, hopefully the 6th District and each of the counties will also do, through your GOP, a very robust effort to get as many people out to vote as possible. Now, whenever there is this much money, and you have George Soros coming in and playing for John Ossoff, they have a lot of money to spread around a bunch of lies. So, number one, y'all know I didn't buy a car on state money, right? Come on. The Secretary of State's office had a car allowance, so that's number one. Number two, a trip. I have the great honor of being asked by Governor Sonny Perdue to be a member of his delegation on an economic development trip to China. So those things, don't believe all of this stuff. We're putting up a little micro website that everybody can go to if you have friends or neighbors who are asking about it so that you can get all of the facts. Tuesday, watch the television Tuesday and watch your emails. We will launch our TV ad on Tuesday. I think you'll like it a lot. I'm really, really proud of it. It's going to be great. And I hope some of you saw the little snippet about Steve in the paper today. Yes, they talked about his hole-in-one. Any man's dream to have his hole-in-one mentioned in the paper. All right, there is one other election that is coming up that is equally as important as this one. And it is on Tuesday to get this woman right here, Kay Kirkpatrick, elected. The energy, if you are in that state senate district, the energy that you feel for me, please, please put that behind Kay, because let me tell you what will happen. She needs to win and win big for the legislature, because that is a crucial vote in terms of the numbers, the majority that will hold in the state senate. But equally as important, make no mistake about it, the Democrats are going to be watching that race as a bellwether to what might happen in the 6th district race. So know that I'm going to be beating the bushes for Kay. We need every one of you doing that. I hope I'll see some of you on Monday at our rally with Speaker Ryan. It's going to be great. Stay tuned. We know that Vice President Pence is coming. I can't give the date yet, but I will as soon as I can. I appreciate all of you so very much for your friendship, your love, and your prayers. God bless y'all.
Somebody has a gift for your husband that she wants to give to you to give to your husband.
This is my good friend Sandy here. I don't know what she's got up her sleeve, but you never know.
Well, we all know what a sharp dresser Steve Handel is. But he's currently missing something. And Steve. He needs it. So, Steve.
Mike. Go ahead, open the box and let her put them on her husband.
No, I'm going to let Sandy do the honors.
Okay. Put them on. Put them on and wear them with pride. Hey,
Sandy.
y'all. Thank y'all. God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sandy, and thank you, Karen, for all that you do for our district. And we are all going to get out hard and work for you this weekend and over the next 4 or 5 weeks. That right, everybody? If you can come here and be at a breakfast, you can go door to door, or you can make phone calls to Karen Handel and Kay Kirkpatrick. I want to let Kay talk to y'all a little bit about her race because it's coming up this Tuesday. So if you live in Civic District 32, Judson Hills, former district, we need you to vote. If you haven't voted yet, if you have, take your neighbors to the poll. And please, please, let's help get these two great women elected.
So I haven't done this before, and I'm also older than Karen, so I have little notes. I want to thank all of you all for helping me get this far. My retirement hasn't actually worked out the way that I thought it was going to. And as you, some of you know, I retired from Resurgence Orthopedics 3 months ago. I worked there side by side with Dr. Tom Price for many years, and he's been an inspiration to me. And I want to thank him in absentia for that. I want to reassure you that although there were 5 Republicans in my race, we are now all united. And I didn't know in December that I would be the one still standing here in May, but we are working hard to maintain this very important Senate seat, which holds the supermajority downtown for the Republicans. So please help me do that. I'm running against a very liberal Democrat who's a divorce lawyer who really likes spending other people's money. I had a debate with her last Monday, and it was very clear that she doesn't understand that somebody's got to pay for this stuff. So I'm looking forward to not giving her an opportunity to do that. This race has been talked about in the paper as the canary in the coal mine, although really there hasn't been a whole lot in the Atlanta paper about this race. And for that reason, I would like to win, but more importantly, to win decisively, to send a strong message to the Democrats that we as Republicans have our act together.
Amen. Yay.
Yeah. Having 2 separate runoff dates has been very confusing for the voters in my district. And the biggest challenge is for people to understand that May 16th is gonna come and go. And so we've got to get the Republicans out there on Tuesday. Early voting is completed. The early voting numbers look good, but I'm not taking anything for granted. I'm running like I'm behind and working very hard to get out the vote. So if you know people in East Cobb or Sandy Springs, please be sure that they know that this election is Tuesday, May 16th, and by 7 o'clock that night, it's gonna be over. I wanted to ask you for your prayers as well. And if you've never done this before, you may not know what's involved with that, but it's been a fairly grueling process that I am looking forward to having this phase behind me. And there's something very special that happens on May 16th for me, and that is that my dad, who's a World War II vet, is turning 98 on Tuesday. He is one of the I won't say the last, but one of the dwindling number of the greatest generation that's still around. And my goal is to really make him proud on May 16th. Thank you all very much for your support. I have to go now because Cobb County is doing something for me today. They're doing canvassing and also a barbecue at lunch. So if you guys can help me or have any suggestions or thoughts, I would really appreciate it. But I can promise you that I'm working as hard as I can to get down under the gold dome to be your next state senator for East Cobb and Sandy Springs. Thank you very much.
Good job.
To accommodate our 2 candidates who have to get out on the campaign trail. But I now want to turn over the microphone to Trey Kelly, our chairman, and ask him to lead us in the invocation. I hope he's not mad at me because I don't think I told him I was going to ask him to do that, but I know he'll do a great job, so please recognize Trey.
Thank you, Angelyn. Welcome, everybody, to We're in May. Yeah, it's hard to keep track these days with the election, but May Fulton GOP breakfast. I'm Trey Kelly, chairman of the party. Cannot be more excited about the elections that we have going on. It's really our time to shine, to show, obviously, the rest of the country with these two races, our strength and our candidate strength. I would like to encourage everybody today. I've got my shoes in the car, so I'll be going from here to start knocking on some doors in Sandy Springs if anybody would like to join me. Also, too, Monday night, we'll be making a big deal about getting out the vote for Kay's race. So y'all please, if you can do that, whether it's making some calls at the headquarters, we'll have some pizza, or if you can get out and get some exercise in Sandy Springs, that would be great. Great help, too. So without further ado, I'm going to start us off in an invocation and then ask Roger Wise to do our pledge. Y'all bow with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us together this wonderful weekend. Please be with our candidates to keep them safe and represent you and the Republican Party in the way that you want. Please be with our elected officials here locally and in Washington, D.C. to represent you in the way that you want, and also to give them the strength, the vision, and the fortitude to lead our community and our country. Please be with all of us this weekend as we volunteer and spend time with our families on Mother's Day weekend. And of course, as always, thank you for all the many blessings that you give us. Amen.
Amen.
Roger, microphone's yours.
I don't need a microphone. Folks, you just heard from Karen, heard from the good doctor. The whole country is looking at Georgia. The whole country is looking at our districts. I get a call last month from the RNC. Said, Mr. Wise, we want to do some PSAs on veterans issues and active duty military. And we were given your name and wondering if you would help us with this. Said, we're looking at some place in the country we can come to that has a proven record of supporting their veterans and supporting their military. Said, well, if you'd like to come down and look around, we'll show you around, Bubba. So the young gentleman came down and we looked around and they chose our American Legion Post 201 in Alpharetta. We have a Sherman tank. We've got a 50 caliber deck gun. We've got a Huey helicopter. We've got a Sabre jet. And they came yesterday morning and started shooting at 8 o'clock in the morning. Now, this is like Hollywood. I mean, they had the makeup artist and the hair person and the director and, you know, the lighting specialist and whatever. They finished at 8 o'clock last night. They filmed all day long. Some of the stuff, and I officially can't talk to Karen about this because it's some rules or whatever. Some of those are going to be on Karen's behalf. Talking about this kid, Ossoff. Now, he is a kid, and we don't need children in Washington. We need mature adults in Washington. Karen, she brought up the point, and this comes up to me. We need to talk to everybody we know about this election. People will come up to me and say, how about this car thing? You explain. The Secretary of State's office gets a car allowance. It ain't no big deal. How about all this money she spent? She took over an office that was in disrepair. I've been down there 40 years. Max Cleveland left that office in disrepair. He was running for Senate the whole time he was Secretary of State. She updated that office system and brought it into the 21st century. She didn't spend money, she made an investment in the state of Georgia, which makes Georgia a better place. She was humble when the president, when the governor said, I'm going to China on a trade mission and I want you to go with me. Yeah, she went to China on a trade mission. Today, they're one of our biggest biggest trade partners. Georgia just was named the fourth time in a row the best state in the United States to do business. So explain these things to your friends.
and tell your friends this is the most important, and this is true, this is the most important vote they will ever make. And Karen Handel is the right person for this job. And we owe it to Tom Price and this district to send Karen to Washington. So start talking with everybody you know, because reopening this registration thing, I saw it with Bill Campbell and some of the others at the city of Atlanta. Get on the bus and go vote exactly who we tell you to vote for, and here's a certificate for $15 worth of free groceries at Publix. So we are going to have to get out the vote. Get out the vote for Karen Handel. Get out the vote for the good doctor. We are being watched nationwide, and we owe it to the conservative agenda, to the Republican Party, to maintain those seats and keep them in our fold. Now, that being said, freedom is not free, and you've heard me say this 1,000 times. As we're here today, I want all the veterans in the room, on your feet, that means stand up. Thank you for your service to our country. As we're here this morning having breakfast, free Americans, these individuals you see standing in front of you have paid their tabs. But there's young men and young women all over the world this morning paying their tabs. Whether we like it or not, we're at war. We are at war. And they're there defending our country and defending our honor. So when you see a veteran, walk up to them and say, thank you for your service to our country. And when you see one in uniform, salute them and thank them for their service to our country. Remembering freedom is not free, someone has to pay for it. So now I want everybody else in the room to stand and join these great patriots. And let's pledge a flag to the greatest country in the world, the United States of America.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
God bless America.
Amen.
Thank you, Roger. We've got another great program here today. A lot going on as usual. June 3rd, we have the state convention in Augusta. We have a chairman's race for the first time in 4 years for the state. It's obviously a big deal. I can't thank the gentlemen enough that are running for running. It's a big job. Fulton County is a big county, but the state's even bigger deal, obviously. So thank you all for doing what you're doing. They can probably, I was wondering if there was a Georgia GOP chairman candidate car that they've been driving around in together, because I know they've been doing this a lot. So we definitely appreciate them being here this morning. We've got a couple of distinguished former Fulton state GOP leaders. Three-time term state chairman Bob Shaw. So he wanted to be with us this weekend. He's in California. If you friends with him on Facebook, you saw he got a star on the Walk of Fame. So not really, but anyway, check Facebook. But he couldn't be with us, but he did want to ask a question, so we have that here sealed in an envelope that Angelyn will ask after they give their opening dialogue. But I'm going to first, real quick, ask our first vice chair. We have a few first vice chair for the state candidates that come up here. We're going to give them 1 minute before we get going, so I'm going to ask them to sit here so they're ready to go. So if you would like to do that, that'd be great. And I am going to hand it off to Angelyn and Greg. Thank all of y'all for coming, and let's get out and get these folks elected. Yeah. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Trey. I'd like to quickly go around the room and make sure that we introduce any elected officials or party officers. So we'll start with the table over here, and if you are an elected official or an elected party officer, please just stand up and state your name and your position. Scanning row one.
I'll just jump in.
Thank you.
David Belisle, Mayor of Alpharetta, also candidate for Secretary of State.
This is Charlie up there. But, I'm Bob Bushman. I'm Fulton County GOP Secretary.
Michael McNeely, current First Vice Chair of the Georgia Republican Party and candidate for chair.
Bob pointed out I missed Charlie Wingo. I'm at a bit of a height disadvantage, so sometimes I can't see over people like him.
Would you like a chair?
I might need to stand on this one. Nobody's sitting in it. So, Charlie.
Charlie Wingo, Vice Chair of the Fulton County Republican Party.
Nancy McCord, your current state treasurer and a candidate for re-election, unopposed. Thank you.
In the room.
Yes. Hello.
Craig Kidd, our first vice chair.
Congrats. Loaded district chairman. Fulton County's 5% of the district. We're very proud 5%.
Now, what I like about doing it this way is that if you don't get recognized, it's your fault. So is there anybody else? Going once, going twice. I hear some crying in the background.
Future Republican.
Okay. Well, then I see that we have three candidates for first vice chair of the Georgia Republican Party. So I'm going to let each of them have 1 minute. Is someone pointing to try to get my attention? No? Okay. All right, I'm just seeing things sometimes. We'll let each of them have 1 minute to introduce themselves and tell them about their campaign. So first person, I'll just turn around and get unwound from the cord here. Carolyn Fisher.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Goodness gracious, I have been, I've just told the people that are running for chairman and some of the people that are running for first vice chairman that we've been together at least four times this week. We all need to just get a beach house together. We all know our each other's speeches and everything. I am the past chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party, the past first vice chairman, the past second vice chairman, a past precinct chairman. I'm a member of the Republican Leadership for Georgia. I'm a state committee woman, and I was a national delegate last year in Cleveland. I also am a fighter. I will not allow this party to go down in flames. I will do whatever it takes to help and assist our chairman to do that. I have asked to please put me on the road. You have no idea how some of these counties feel who are outside of the Beltway. They feel completely and totally disconnected. I'm a fighter. I actually joined the Israeli Defense Force and fought in Israel for a month in 2015. I hope you will vote for me on June 3rd. I hope to see you there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. One minute and 15 seconds.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. I was a little bit slack on prompting you. So we'll
get slowly more strict on
yeah,
that.
Yes. But give them 1 minute and 15 seconds just to be fair.
That's 75 seconds for the non-math major.
Hey, there was a question from the floor. Can you throw biscuits? I'm going to let you use your best judgment.
I thought that wouldn't answer.
I think you meant it, me. Oh. All right, our next candidate is Vivian Childs, and Nate Porter is going to keep time for you. 75 seconds.
Thank you. Let me begin by saying go Kay and go Karen.
Yeah, that's right.
I am here. My name is Vivian Childs. I'm a minister, an educator, military spouse. My husband served for 30 years in the United States Air Force. My father spent 28 years in the United States Navy, and he was a World War II veteran. Why am I running for first vice chair, and I'm asking for your vote today? It's because I care too much about this party not to. If you were looking on the cards, since we don't have a minute, my resume is pretty much on there, many of the things. But I have served this state on a local, a state, and a national level. With the RNC, when they came out with their growth and opportunity project, I was one of the writers on that project. When I went to the national convention in 2012, of all the delegates there, I gave the first motion from the floor. I'm a difference maker in our community. When we say we have outreach, we have outreach. We have been, voter turnout is now increased, and I have served as a precinct chair, parliamentarian, and district chairman. Also, thank you very much for your vote.
And our final candidate.
Hello, my name is Kenneth King Brown. I'm running for first vice chair. And most people want to know, why are you Republican? Well, I've been Republican since 1956. Ooh, that's right, do the numbers. Do the math. Unfortunately, I didn't realize it until 1991. I'm a soul learner, what can I say? I was invited to a Republican meeting in Cobb County. And I said, when the person that invited me was a Republican, said, you should go. I said, do I look Republican to you? I'm from Detroit, Michigan, went to University of Michigan. Jesse Jackson was my commencement speaker. And my grandfather was international rep for the UAW. Do I look Republican to you? Well, I went to the meeting. And I said, what do you believe in? What do you got in writing? And they gave me the Republican principles. Anybody have the Republican principles on you? It says strong defense. The best government is a government that's close to the people. Freedom, free enterprise, personal responsibility. And when I saw this, I said, I'm in. I'm ready to go to work. I've been second vice chair for the party, chairman for the state, for the Black Republican Council. And I'm running because I am from Detroit. I graduated from the University of Michigan, and Jesse Jackson was my commencement speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ken.
Thank you, Ken.
Well,
I'm in.
Thank you. All right, I think this is most people's favorite part in the program. It's time for the comedy hour. Actually, it's going to be like a comedy 5 minutes. But like to recognize Greg, and if you could talk long enough to let me get a plate of food, that would be fantastic. Thank you.
Well, morning, y'all. Thanks for coming out. I hope everybody got the news last night that they made 85 great again, right? The Georgia Department of Transportation finished the bridge. My wife and I were really fired up about it. We drank a bunch of beers and hired Uber to drive us back and forth like 30 times. We're getting it broken in for Monday morning, so y'all can thank us for that. Another person that was really excited about the 85 completion was the Cobb County Sheriff, Jeff Mann. He said it'll shave 10 minutes off his Saturday night commute to Fremont Park. I have been suspicious of him ever since he named Pee Wee Herman his chief deputy. I think we need to get Brandon Beach to change the North Fulton Chamber of Commerce slogan to live in DeKalb, party in Fulton. Oh, God. Tomorrow's Mother's Day, also known as the most confusing day of the year at the Kardashian house. So that's why I'm going to say that. We're on the phone call. I guess y'all have been paying attention to some of the airlines, right? There's a lot of trouble in the air. You almost get into a fist fight every time you get up there. Spirit Airlines, been in the news, they canceled 9 flights the other day. They've actually opened up a new class. Everybody flies coach, but they have a brand new class where lucky passengers get seated handcuffed between Nancy Pelosi and Maxine Waters. And 50% of it's kind of risky to do this though, because 50% of them have gone clinically insane after the flight, especially if you're flying like to Los Angeles. If it's an hour and a half or less, you're usually pretty good. And a very small percentage of them have actually gnawed off their wrist to escape. They call that flying coyote in the phrase. Trump has been busy firing people, hasn't he? Yeah. When he said he was going to create all the jobs, he didn't mean all of them would be in the private sector now, did he? Last Friday, they announced 211,000 jobs were created, and after James Comey, it's 211,001. So we've got a new FBI guy. If you think about it, Donald Trump fired Hillary Clinton and James Comey within a span of 6 months. So that's a job well done, right? And finally, guys, I'm going to wrap it up with another funny little anecdote. My wife is from Ecuador, as many of y'all have met her. She has a lot of family coming up here now. And one of her nephews, technically my nephew by marriage, he recently got his first job here. And I warned him about his first paycheck maybe not having 100% of his revenue. Sure enough, yesterday he starts frantically texting me and complaining about FICA, and federal income tax and state income tax, and he even texted me a picture of his paycheck. And he speaks very good English, but the text either was a little, was broken English is what I call for the Latin folks. And he sent me this thing and he said, "I am so disappointed with them taking my tax dollars." And I just replied back very simply, very succinctly, "Welcome to the Republican Party, sir." So we have one more convert from the great country of Ecuador. So anyway, guys, I'm going to get ready to start the panel here. We've transformed this table magically, and our four candidates are going to mosey on up here. And who's are you moderating, right? Cool. So anyway, thank you, guys.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. My name is Michael McNeely, and I'm a candidate for Georgia Republican Party chairman. A little bit about me and my background. I'm a Georgia native, grew up in Renz, Georgia, near Augusta, Georgia, with my mother and father who adopted me at 9 months old, so the right to life issue is very important to me. I served in the Boy Scouts, and I'm a proud Eagle Scout. Graduated from high school, attended and graduated from Georgia Southern University with a degree in criminal justice. I was a police officer for 14 years. I served in the Georgia Army National Guard, and currently an executive with Georgia Juvenile Justice. In the party, I started volunteering doing the grassroots work during Governor Sonny Perdue's re-election, and also served in my local party in Douglas County, was a vice chair there. Served as the political director of the Georgia Young Republicans, chairman of the Georgia Black Republican Council, and currently serve as first vice chair of the Georgia Republican Party. I'm glad to be here. I'm asking for your vote to continue to serve with you, because we've got a lot of great things we can do, and I have the experience to help us do that. Thank you.
Hey, everyone. I'm Alex Johnson, and I'm running for chairman of the State Republican Party. A little bit about me. I'm from DeKalb County, Georgia. I have my own legal practice there. A lot more of that information is on the push cards in front of all of you. I just want to take a minute to point out that what's going on right now in the state GOP is a problem. I've run in the past couple cycles, and the party is in deep financial distress. 2 years ago, I stood up against that, and it's only gotten worse. We need a state Republican Party that's credible, that has a strong infrastructure, so that what's going on right now in the 6th District doesn't happen again, meaning that we need more people involved throughout the state of Georgia. We need a state party that's serving the state, that's letting every Republican know how to be involved, how to make an impact, how to run for office, how to get involved in campaigns, how to be in touch with elected officials. That's what the state party should be doing. It should be serving all of you. So with that, I look forward to talking to you more.
Good morning. I after about 25 of these forums, I think actually I'd prefer that Greg stay up here with a stand-up routine that that he started on. And good morning. My name is John Watson. I am indeed a candidate for chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. Background, 25-year involvement, began as a high school kid in the 80s with a bad hairdo and a convert and believer in Ronald Reagan. And obviously those are still the ideals and principles as forwarded today with the president and President Trump. Finance director for Congressman Bob Barr, finance director at the Georgia Republican Party, where I met my wife Kimberly, campaign manager for Mike Bowers, whereby we had the campaign headquarters years ago just on the river in 1998. Life got very interesting. I had the opportunity with Governor, then Sonny, simply Sonny Perdue, to be his chief political consultant in his historic race for governor, later his chief of staff and campaign co-chair for David Perdue. Appreciate the opportunity this morning.
Make sure this cord's long. Yeah.
Otherwise you can just strangle
John. We don't want to strangle any of the other candidates. We're good. Good morning, I'm Mike Welsh. I'm candidate for the Republican Party chairman of Georgia. I'm a Georgia boy. I was born in North Georgia, graduated from high school in DeKalb County. I've lived in Columbus, Hazelhurst, and currently in Augusta. I have 2 degrees from the University of Georgia, a bachelor's degree in finance and a master's degree in accounting. And I also found my lovely bride, Susie, who on the Monday after the convention will be our 35th wedding anniversary. So y'all really need to be praying for me because there's not been a lot of planning on that. So I spent a career fixing problems and helping business and organizations just like the state party that have serious concerns in front of them, solve them in an efficient and foremost manner that can be well done. And as that, I have the skills and talents that are necessary to address the issues that we have today. And as a former consultant, we spend a lot of time with plans. You'll find my plan on the back of the push card, and I look forward to the debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. In his opening remarks, Trey mentioned that Bob Shaw, former Fulton County Party Chairman, founder, and State Party Chairman, submitted a question. He's not able to be with us today, but he submitted a little envelope, and I just opened it just now. So our first question comes from Bob Shaw.
As a former three-term state party chairman.
Well, I'm not a former three-term state party chairman, so I didn't think it would sound believable, but I'll just use my regular voice. I did not get elected and re-elected by dividing our members. Frankly, I have been disappointed by the negative tone of our candidates. Shame, shame, shame. I'm kidding. I'm teasing. Okay. We did not build the foundation that helped lead our party to the majority by attacking Republicans and our party operations. If you want to be our next chairman, specifically, tell us how you are going to be the one who unites and grows the GOP. And we'll start with Alex.
The most important thing looking forward for the state GOP is looking at the numbers. We have about 3,000 people, 3,000 to 4,000 people involved in the state GOP, while over 2 million people voted for Donald Trump in this last presidential election. As a state organization, the state level is failing. The state level is deeply in debt due to pretty much giving jobs to those who were supporters in the past for the idea that that's just disconnection from the county parties. And we need to move past that. We need to have a state party that serves the people, not just the political industry. And we will unify the party through success. We will win. We will get thousands more people involved in the party. We will funnel them into the county parties where leaders like you can help show people how to be involved, knocking on doors, running for office, and doing the things that we need to do to spread our principles so that people will vote Republican. We need to be converting people who are Democrats or independents and understanding why the truth of our policies helps lives. And by doing that, our party will be unified because we all want to win.
Ladies and gentlemen, the path forward for our party is really quite simple. For those of you that head to Augusta, you will have the opportunity to discern the next leader. And as you look and define the leader, you must look at the times we are in. We are broke financially, we are mismanaged as an organization, and we are headed into the critical 2018 battle election cycle of political combat that is 2018 to discern who our next governor is. As you look at those attributes of the moment, I would ask you to look at the attributes of the candidates. I have been a professional fundraiser, having raised resources throughout my career, working and leading organizations to the tune of $25 million. I have led campaigns and organizations that have won and defeated Democrats across this state. Those are unique characteristics of mine, no disrespect to the fine gentlemen that I stand with and travel this state with. But they are different, and in this moment in time, as we head into the into the future, that's the type of leadership I would appeal to you for.
You'll notice on my push card that the very first item is to communicate a vision that unites the party, because when we're united, we make things happen. You'll see that under my leadership, that I will inspire each and every one of you to be the best Republican you can possibly be. Because when you're inspired, you have passion. And when you have passion, people like to be around you. So that grants you influence into their lives. And through that influence, you can convince them to give up two of their most precious resources, their time and their treasure. And when people give up those two things, they will have an impact on their communities, their counties, their state, and this party. And as your next GOP chairman, I will give you that kind of leadership.
We've got to obviously unite the party. And I remember when I ran for first vice chair, I had support from those that supported each of the chairman's candidates. And a lot of that comes from listening to people and incorporating the ideas and the experience that we have from the men and women of our party from around the state. Because whoever you elect as chairman, they will not get the job done alone. It takes all of us working hand in hand to do that. And we have to message a vision to all communities. And it starts right here with those that are already in this party. So when we talk about why we need to raise money and why we need to go out and go door to door and phone banking and all these things, we need to talk about more than just we want to defeat Democrats. We need to talk about our principles, how they made this country great, and how they apply to men and women around the state. So when we go to those that we're asking money from, then they will see and hear a clear vision, and that they will see us be fiscally conservative and managing a budget within our party. So when we do these things, any of us as men of this party can get the job done, and we will.
Okay, this one might remind you of a job interview question. Describe your style as a manager and any relevant management experience that you have that will help you effectively lead the state party. This is from an operational perspective, your management experience that will help you be an effective chairman of the state party in terms of organizing the staff, the volunteers, and the operation of the party that makes it run effectively. So we will start with John.
Uh, Thanks, gentlemen. I did have the opportunity, and I made reference to this in my introduction, but nonetheless, I had the high honor of serving the taxpayers of Georgia and the governor of this great state, Sonny Perdue, as his chief of staff. And in that opportunity and in that honor, I did indeed manage a staff of 80 individuals, a budget that was in the multi-million dollars. And in that role as a chief of staff, you have to do a number of things, some difficult, some easy. Most importantly, you're telling the governor no and telling other people that when he says yes, he actually means no. But the reality is this, I manage this way. I manage collaboratively, I lead by example, but at the end of the day, when the tough decisions are made, I'm the person that makes those decisions, and I seek the opportunity to lead by cajoling and or bringing along whatever it takes to bring us forward as a party. But I do lead as a consensus builder.
I have led large organizations as a business individual, and one of the things that was really important to me was when I was working for Coca-Cola Enterprises as the division manager of a billion-dollar division, I had about 60 people working for me, both permanent and consultants. And they hired a crew to come in and evaluate our leadership styles. And this professional person that was focused on how the leadership structures and styles work took an inventory of all of us that worked for him and the folks there. And he came back and said, you know, I've been doing this 20 years and this is the first time it's ever happened. And I said, what happened? He said, you have all your direct reports and every one of them thinks that your management style is their management style. So folks, I know how to communicate with folks. I know how to lead them based on what they need to know and how they need to be addressed and taught and led, because that's the way I am.
Having served as an executive with juvenile justice over the years, I've managed as little as $7 million, upwards to about $40 million. And you have to prioritize, you have to be fiscally conservative and make sure that you're allocating resources properly. I've hired and fired staff and provided good customer service. And that's one of the things that we've lacked in the state party is when you call or email, what kind of response do you get? You should be getting the kind of response that is prompt and addresses your concerns or needs. Fundamentally, in leadership, I believe in stewardship and leadership that is responsive to you, helping to train others, incorporating your ideas, and bringing us together. Because as I said earlier, everyone brings value to the table, and we need to see the experience and background that you provide in what we do and the strategy we have as a Georgia Republican Party.
Right now, the way the state party has ended up with over $300,000 in debt is because we haven't been using our resources effectively. And the resources of a volunteer organization, as opposed to a business paid organization, are the volunteers around the state that actually get Republicans elected. The people in Fulton County and all the other counties that work to make that happen. My experience, I've been leading volunteer organizations ever since college. I've been in charge of the DeKalb County Young Republicans. Most recently, I've led the Georgia Republican Assembly in growth from when I took over a little over a year ago, 6 members to over 170 paid members right now with 4 local chapters. The way that I've led that is by doing the work necessary to bring in new people, showing the resources necessary to encourage people to be involved, and serving the local chapters and helping support their events. That's what the state party needs to be doing, in addition to supporting events, letting the entire state know why to vote Republican, why to be involved in the party. That's what we need the entire GOP to be in favor of.
All right, the first response will come from Mike. I'll get a little more organized with this next time. What is your current day job? Will you continue in that role if elected? And will that help or hurt your ability to spend time fundraising, building the party, and actively engaging with the grassroots?
My current day job is I operate and manage an industrial coatings facility in Thompson, Georgia. It is owned by a private investor, and I have the full backing and support of both my boss and the investor to engage in this activity. He's a very active Republican out of state. So I see it as a big value win for the party, because I already have access to some out-of-state donors that we do not normally have. And I also have access through his network to some very large donors that are not normally associated with the state of Georgia. So there's a brand new pool that's available to us because of my relationship with my employer. They are very flexible, and I will be able to invest an awful lot of time. And as I've talked about before, I'm an avid user of technology. In one of my previous assignments, I was able to run an operation that was over $30 million that was global in nature.
As I mentioned, I'm an executive with Georgia Juvenile Justice. I will continue in that role. In order to run for chairman and previously to run for first vice chair, I had to get the approval of the agency. They knew exactly what I was being a part of and what I was doing. Right now, as first vice chair, I'm making fundraising calls. I'm traveling the state. I'm doing media requests, traveling D.C. when necessary, and being responsive to you as the grassroots. So if I'm elected chairman, I will continue to do that, managing my time well between work, party, and family.
Right now, I have my own legal practice. That will continue. I do personal injury, civil rights, law, and a little bit of business representation. I also have a lot of time right now devoted to the Georgia Republican Assembly. If, when elected chairman of the state party, I'll resign as that, so that organization can hold me accountable like it's designed to do. I believe that the legal practice will be very useful in helping out the state party for two reasons. First, right now we're currently involved in a lawsuit, which has led to over $300,000 of legal fees. So due to a racial discrimination suit, I'll definitely make sure that doesn't happen again. The second thing is that there are plenty of lawyers around the state that are Republicans, that do not know about the party, that would be great donors to the party, but they don't see any value in the Republican Party. They don't even hear about the state party and that it exists. Through my networking and abilities, through my legal practice, I will definitely be able to go and reach out to donors and get them involved in the party, people who have not been involved in the past. Thank you.
I'm a pediatrician. I'm just kidding. Everybody knows. I'm the lobbyist in the group, gang. I own a small business. I indeed have the opportunity to work at the Capitol. I do so and run my own business, control my own time. I think it's high time the Georgia Republican Party and the grassroots activists had an advocate and had a lobbyist at the Capitol. I have had the relationship and continue to have relationships over 25 years with the men and women that are the leaders of this party. We must address a major fact that is holding our party back, of which that we do not have adequate relationships between Georgia Republican Party leadership and the state capitol. That will end under my chairmanship. Not all the times will we agree, but the reality is we will have the opportunity to be in front of each other behind closed doors, work out our issues, and get those men and women working on our behalf and fundraising with us.
Thank you. Next question, and we will start with Michael on this one. The state party is struggling financially. As chairman, how will you get the party out of debt and into a financially viable position so that it can be prepared to be an effective campaign engine for the 2018 elections? And I'm going to make this a compound question so that we can have more time for audience Q&A. No, I'm not. Let's focus on the money. Just kidding.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, just like you do in your household, you don't spend more than you bring in. And we have to do that as a state party. It doesn't matter if we're talking about $100 or $100 million. The fundamental principle is the same. And then we have to have a budget. What are we going to spend? How are we going to prioritize it? How are we going to move forward in the Georgia Republican Party? And then you have to reduce the current debts that's there. So we have to allocate funds towards the reduction of that debt. And you have to have a vision, because if you want to grow the party, if you want people to write checks, they have to hear what you have in mind. How are you using the money? Specifically, what are your plans and what are your goals and what are your next steps along the way, so that when they hear those things and hear them articulated clearly, they're willing to give. And then we also have to have a grassroots fundraising opportunity as well, because I know when I came into the party, As a police officer making $26,000, I didn't have a lot of money. But I gave what I could, and I was valued and was appreciated. And we have to allow everyone the opportunity to have value.
When it comes down to fixing the financial situation, you need to ask yourselves, why do you give money to an organization? And the answer, in most cases, is because you believe in what they're doing. Not just because you want to see someone elected, because then you can give to a candidate. Not just because you believe in a specific issue, because then you can give to a PAC. And trust me, that's what's going on now. We need the state Republican Party to be doing things that justify donations, meaning we need to be bringing in new people. We need to be showing people how lower taxes, family values, they help people's lives. That's how we get more people involved and expand our donor base. We also need to make sure that with elected officials, we're advertising their successes in the Gold Dome that align with our principles so that we're, helping them get reelected, and two, when we ask them for help with funds, they don't turn and laugh at us and say, what does the party do to help us? Because that's currently the way the state party looks, and under my leadership, that will end. We will be financially solvent.
To accomplish our goals as a party, we have to settle the lawsuit, ladies and gentlemen. We have to acknowledge and understand that major contributors, small contributors, medium contributors are looking at the Georgia Republican Party and not prepared to spend good money after bad. We have to bring that into a conclusion. Secondly, we've got to be able to have a fundraiser in chief in the form of a chairman who has a 25-year network and experience of raising resources that acknowledge and knows that we've got to have contributors at the $5 level, many times, most time, understanding that those men and women mean more to this party than those that give $250,000. With that being said, we also need a chairman who has the capacity to look across the table from men and women, make a commitment to them that their finances, their money will be spent wisely, and it will go to voter contact. And when they give $250,000, $100,000, whatever the large number is, that the resources will be spent adequately and wisely. We've got to have someone that does that on a daily basis, every day, with a sense of urgency.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as the person standing before you with 2 degrees in finance, not just one, and understands intimately the concepts and relationships between taking money in and money leaving the door, I'm the person that has presented the plan. It's on my website, mikewelshforga.com, that has a fundraising plan. And for the first time actually recognizes that we have put the burden of fundraising on Atlanta for far too long, and we need to shift it out into the rest of the state. And you'll see that my plan includes a lot of fundraising activities that are out and about throughout the state to bring them forward. But just raising money is not sufficient. You have to recognize that everything the party does from top to bottom has to add value to us as the grassroots. If it does not, it needs to be cut, eliminated, and shut down. If it is not being done and does add value, it needs to be raised up and started. And that's the kind of leadership you'll get from me.
All right, this is going to be the last question from me. So if anybody... So if anybody has any questions in the audience, I'm giving you a heads up to start thinking about them now. We'll take a couple. All right, the Democrats are going to be fighting really hard in 2018. They're going to try to put Georgia in play. So what will you do to establish a grassroots infrastructure to ensure that we're able to hold the governor's seat and all of our other statewide offices? And this one will first go to Alex.
2 years ago, I saw the problem coming, and that's why I ended up becoming chairman of the Republican Assembly and growing it significantly around the state. Back in early 2016, I was out volunteering, going to different meetings of primary candidates like the Cobb for Trump group to show them how to be involved in the party and get tied in. And now many of them are involved in the Republican Party in this state. Again, the Republican Assembly went from 6 people to over 170 paid members under my leadership in just over a year. I've already been doing it, and that's what we're going to make sure to focus the state GOP on doing, is getting the word out on a large level in every county and every corner of this state, so that we could just send out a text message to get 10, 20, 30,000 volunteers to help out with infrastructure in races like Karen's race in the 6th. That's what we should be able to do. That's what the Democrats have been doing. I live in the 6th district. I had 3 Democratic door knockers come by my house and no Republicans. That's a problem, and we'll fix it by getting more people involved that all of you can train and lead.
Obviously, the foot soldiers that put the blood, sweat, and tears into this process are the grassroots of this party. The reality is they are not educated, embraced, supported, or encouraged by the Georgia Republican Party at the staff level. We must have an organization led by a leader, led by a chairman that says the 159 counties, the auxiliary groups that are the muscle of this party, are embraced, encouraged, and communicated with on a daily basis to make certain that they have the resources, they have the support, and they have ultimately the fundamental knowledge that the Georgia Republican Party has their back. Right now, many of these organizations, most of these organizations, cannot have the simple courtesy of a return phone call. That should be a fireable offense, and we must understand, and the chairman must lead by example that says, look, the customers of this party are our county organizations. They enable us to win, not the other way around.
You'll notice on my push card, the second point in my 4-point plan is to build a digital infrastructure so that we can turn Cobb and Gwinnett red again. How does that work? Well, I'll give you a perfect example. A couple of years ago, I met with a young lady. She's Congressman Heiss's Deputy Chief of Staff, Jessica Hayes. And they said, Jessica, what would happen if we put about 50 minority conservatives in a room? She said, it'd be amazing. I said, can you raise the money if I give you the people? She said, absolutely. So we went out, and through digital marketing and digital technology, we identified 250 minorities, secured a facility at Payne College, which is a historically black college in Augusta, got in a nationally recognized speaker, and had an incredible event. We had 200 conservative minorities attend that event in Augusta. Because we found them, we targeted them, and we will continue to do that.
The United Party is one that's working together, and we talk about grassroots a lot today, and everywhere we go, we're talking to you about what's important about our party. I've worked my way through the ranks of this party, working with you across the state to do the fundamental things that we need to do to win, to make the phone calls, to go door to door, to wave the signs, making the personal contacts, engaging all communities and taking no one for granted. We have to continue with that. Part of that is going to be training. We need formalized training for our leadership and our volunteers. I went through the campaign management college with the Republican National Committee, and some of the fundamental training that they taught there, we need to incorporate here and make it uniform so that when somebody walks in the door and they say they want to help, we don't have to figure out what they need to do. We've got it laid out for them any time of the year, certainly during elections, but 365 days a year, regardless of what's going on, because we've got to be prepared at all times. We've got to grow, and we've got to do it together. And all of us that come to the tables and are Republicans need to work together to get that done.
Thank you. All right, do we have any questions from the audience? Okay, now, I see 2 hands. A couple rules. We're going to give the candidates 45 seconds to respond to these questions. And I know that sometimes questions require a little bit of context, but please make sure that you're asking if the question is shorter than the candidate's response. So we'll start with Betsy.
Okay. Hi. Good morning. My question is really simple. This is a job interview, and I look at it is that you're going to be responsible for the Republican funds in this state, as well as to get rid of the debt that we have. So I'd like to know what your FICO score is, because that is a telltale sign of how you're going to be. I just looked at mine. Mine's 805. All right. So it's intrusive, but I'm not looking at your whole credit report. And if you can tell me I'm a little bit, I've got chutzpah for asking this. And it's just a good telltale sign as how you're going to treat our funds.
Okay, thank you, Betsy. No, that is a good question. I'm going to say the opinion of the chair is that I would love to hear your second best question, because I know you have another good question, and we're going to...
I formulated it.
Okay, well, I'll come back to you. Yes, ma'am, over there, I saw your hand up.
We've heard a lot about education, growing the party, and we need to unite and all that stuff. Do each of you have a plan right now in place to hit the bricks running, if you are the winner, to start to educate our people like the Democrats are doing in the colleges and everything? That is how we grow the party, from the bottom up, and we need to start now. Do you have a plan in place right now?
I think John is next in line.
I'll hook this up when you get 30 seconds, just so you know.
Yeah, no, okay, I'm going to say yes for 45 seconds. We have to break it down. What is our commitment to millennials? What is our commitment to youth? I have said that we must demonstrate leadership in the form of saying that college Republicans, as a voting member, will become voting members of the state executive committee to demonstrate that we believe in youth and we believe in their participation in our party. Secondly, I have said that I will have an advisory committee come forward. As a 48-year-old man, I have daughters 16 and 14. In that process are millennials. I've got to put around me a group of millennials to advise me as to the best means of communication. We will then put forward the information and the resources necessary to attract the next level of our party. Otherwise, our party dies out.
Well, I'm glad you asked, because guess what? I'm the planner. I have the plan. It's been out there. I have a plan for pretty much everything, because without a plan, you're going to get exactly where you don't want to be. So I'm also the state advisor for the Teenage Republicans. So I've worked with young groups. I think you need to look at the results. The youngest county chair in this state is a person that's in my old district, Brittany Dasher. She's 28 years old. She's also has been a member of several committees throughout the state convention that I've appointed her to, because my whole thing is to find the next generation of talent, mentor them, and bring them forward. That's my plan.
45 seconds. Okay. So, you know, about a decade worth of grassroots work, that gives me a lot of opportunity to implement a lot of good things. I think one of the first things we need to do, and we've had years ago under Sue Eberhardt, is a grassroots newsletter. It gets the information that we need to get out to the grassroots quickly and efficiently. You get emails from the state party now asking you for money every now and then, but what information are we putting out about specifics, about what we need to do, how we need to do it? We need to empower individuals across our state, as I mentioned earlier. Now, we have an executive committee, we have a state committee, but the chairman also has the ability to incorporate additional committees around millennials, around minorities, around volunteer service, whatever we need to do as a party. We talked about a lot of them today, and we'll implement that quickly.
Well, first, absolutely. If you look on advanceatgop.com, you can see the past 4 years of newsletters and the plans that have been put out by me regarding what needs to be done. But specifically regarding teenage Republicans, college Republicans, educating the new generation, we have to actually be there to make it happen. Similar to when I went to meetings to get people from various primary campaigns involved in the GOP, we also need to be in high schools and colleges. We need to make sure to help, not treat them as a separate organization, even though legally they are, but we need to be out helping get teen Republican chapters started and college Republican chapters started. Not because of some sort of paternalistic idea, but because if we get them started, then we get their parents as well. We can grow our county parties by partnering with those local organizations.
I saw Charlie's hand, and I think Mike would be there.
I have a simple question to ask of you gentlemen. The last time that I received a return phone call from the Georgia State Party was in 2012. What are you guys going to do about training the staff, number one, to show up, and number two, to return phone calls to people that call trying to help the party?
Well, Charlie, it's a darn shame that we have that situation today. but we do. So how do we fix it? Well, you demand the best, and when you set a bar high and you expect it, you'll get it. And not only is it important for them to return your phone call, but it's very important to understand why you called in the first place. Because we lose out on so many opportunities to grab hold of somebody that's just brushing by the party because we don't have the infrastructure to capture that data and then turn that over to somebody that can go out and meet with that person face to face and say, you're important to us, you matter. We don't have that today, but we will.
Been talking about it throughout this campaign about good customer service. Everyone should be valued in this party, and that's part of having your answers, questions answered, phone calls returned. So the chairman is leading the party. That chairman needs to bring in good quality men and women who are professional, who are going to give that good quality service. And if they're not willing to do that, then they will not be there. It's fundamental, and we have to do it. We will do it if I'm the chairman, and we'll bring in good people and to start with the chairman to give you that service you deserve.
Thank you.
I mean, it all starts with the hiring process. In the past, a lot of times, people who just happen to help the chairman get elected happen to get hired by the chairman to be in the state party. That's wrong. We need a merit-based, open hiring process that involves the state committee so that we get the best employees, not those who just happen to help the chairman get elected. Second, you make sure that those people know that they're there to serve the county parties. They're there to serve the volunteers. Just because they're paid doesn't make them more important than the grassroots volunteers. It's the other way around. You all get the people elected. They're there to serve you. And third, when it comes right down to it, if they aren't returning phone calls, they're fired.
I think the issue is this. I don't have any disagreement with anything that my friends up here said. The difference becomes this. Who's done it? Who's run an organization? Who has led a business? Who has run organizations throughout their career? Hired and fired talent. I have the capacity and the knowledge and the resumes to pull out on day one to look out and determine who is the best and the brightest. In 1995, the Georgia Republican Party was a place that aspiring young people wanted to be at. And the reality is that no longer exists. And that must change.
We got two more questions. Gonna go to Betsy and Melvin.
Thank you. I won't ask another financial question.
Not a personal financial question.
Yeah, no personal financial question. Though all of you are great candidates. Only one of you are going to win. So my question to all of you is, whoever wins, will the rest of you get behind this person and help that one person make our party great, and or continue to make our party great, and help raise the funds that are needed to get us out of debt and to put a lot of money back into the coffers?
I'm a conservative Republican, whether I'm chairman or not. I'm going to help the party which has the right principles that work for families and individuals across the state. And I'm committed to that. I've been committed to that for years and will continue to.
Absolutely. I mean, as many of you may know, I ran for chairman two times in the past. I ran 4 years ago and received 40% of the vote. When it didn't seem like the party was cutting it, I put out a newsletter then to try to keep people informed and engaged, let people know about the events going on around the state when the party wasn't cutting it. Same thing 2 years ago. After that election, I went to get more people involved from the primary campaigns that for some reason the state GOP wasn't reaching out to try to get those people involved in the local parties. As chairman, I'll work with all the other candidates to make sure that in the future we all work together if they'll work with me. Thank you.
I've worked on behalf of the party that I love for 25 years, and that will not stop regardless of who the next chairman is. Here's the opportunity we have before us. If we are to continue the domination of the Republican Party that we have seen over the past 15 years, we must acknowledge and understand that we have to come together. Once this process is over at the chairman level, then we're going to have another process moving forward with the primaries for governor, lieutenant governor, secretary of state, on down the line. The Georgia Republican Party and all of us here must lead by example, that says that we are prepared to come together and help the party, just as we are asking the men and women that are defeated ultimately in the process and our nominees then come together. Unity, unity, unity.
Folks, it really boils down to, do you care about the party more than about yourself? And that's a tough question you don't hear asked very often. But you'll hear me ask it. Because at the end of the day, this party's important. It was important to the founding fathers for this country to operate according to the way we picked it to be. Today, we have a two-party system. We don't have a 30-party system. We're not the nuts over in Europe. So either we can be a part of the party, or we can take our marbles and go home. I suggest we all be a part of the party.
Everybody said the purpose of the Republican Party is to elect Republicans. So define Republican and why you consider yourself one.
15 seconds.
Define it.
A Republican is someone who believes that individual rights and communities are stronger than replacing that with government control. And there's a long explanation on my website. Thank you.
Constitution, freedom, balanced budget, religious liberty, term limits, adherence to faith and family.
Life, liberty, and one we just have lost sight of but is so important, the pursuit of happiness, not the pursuit of pleasure, happiness. What do we do to make this country a better place for our children?
We are a party of fiscal and social conservatives. I happen to be both. There are going to be times where we have differences, but we have to agree where we agree, disagree where we won't, and be willing to stand on principle, which I've stood on with faith and faith-related issues and on many others publicly, and we'll continue that working with you.
Okay, the question for those who couldn't hear was, how will you avoid future racial discrimination litigation without pandering to people who you want to join, who are interested in joining the party?
We have to have a conversation with the general counsel, the treasurer, executive committee, state committee, such that we have clear rules, regulations, and policies, just like any business does. And if we have a form and a process, then we can have.
What can we have?
We can have an organization that's run like a business and won't discriminate.
As a business executive who's worked both in very large corporations and very small ones, the key there is having the process in place before you run into a problem, not afterwards.
All right. So you got to have a professional group of men and women working in your staff. I've managed human resources before, been a police officer for 14 years. You respect people, you bring in professionals, and as far as engagement, you don't pander. You talk about the principles in all communities, and you won't have that issue.
I could give a really long legal explanation how to avoid those lawsuits, but the simply put, one, you don't fire someone right after they make a racial discrimination complaint, and two, you make sure to have insurance that covers legal fees for such situations, and you have a trained staff.
All right. I love the enthusiasm from the audience. You guys asked
some great questions. And how about our candidates? They all. All on message, but all a little bit different, I think, exposing, you know, their individual flavors and their qualifications for the job. They were fantastic at following the time instructions, which is really, clearly none of you guys are real politicians because you were right on time. And how about a huge round of applause for our timekeeper, Nate Porter. Thank you so much. Yes, Roger.
I want to say something. I've been around a long time, but I have never seen a more qualified slate of candidates than we have right now. We've got quality individuals, they've got quality credentials, and we are blessed, and we thank you for making yourself available for public service to the state Republican Party.
We have one last person to hear from who is running for statewide office, and he asked if he could have just a minute to announce his race, and that is our mayor of Alpharetta, David Belle Isle.
Perfect. I'll make it very. First of all, thank you for putting yourselves out there, so it is great to have such good choices. I'm David Belle Isle, candidate for Secretary of State, and everyone knows, and I certainly agree, that the first priority of the Secretary of State is the security of our votes and our voter information. That's fantastic. There's also a duty, obviously, to make sure Georgia is the easiest state to start and grow a business, to start and grow a licensed career. But beyond those direct tasks, there's a different role. And that role is keeper of the seal. It's not talked about very often. Look at that, 30 seconds, he's on it, he's on it. But as mayor of Alpharetta, it's been my passion to really make Alpharetta an irresistible city, and to do what Alpharetta does best, which is technology. We are the technology city of the South. And much of the success that Alpharetta has enjoyed, I do believe can be enjoyed by the state of Georgia. But to do that, we need a mayor. Georgia needs a mayor who will be the keeper of its seal. David Belle Isle, candidate for Secretary of State.
You've made Alpharetta almost as good as Sandy Springs, right?
Better. I need another 60 seconds now.
All right. Thank you guys so much, everybody, for being here. I want to recognize a few specific individuals who really make this event possible. All of our officers with the Fulton GOP contributed to the questions that were asked this morning, especially the four candidates who've given of their time to candidly answer a lot of questions from us and all of y'all. I think they'll all be available after the meeting if you have additional questions for them. Charlie Wingo and Kathleen Canada, who helped with the thankless job of registration, and Linda Cupid and Chris Cupid, who are so gracious to host us here in this beautiful venue with the delicious breakfast. Yes, ma'am, absolutely. This is your club.
Thank you all so much for being here, and thank you for making reservations so the food goes around. And I just want to say one thing to you all, why you're here and why we're here. We're here because we believe like you. This is a mission for Chris and I, and we're so excited to be a part. And you know, we've got to stick together, and with these wonderful candidates, it's going to take wonderful each one of us, because we're the ones that are going to be out there. We're the ones that are going to be voting. We've got to, in the beauty shop, in the dentist office, at the cleaners, wherever we are, we have got to tell the story. This is serious business. So be sure you go out today and you tell at least 10 people why we're for Karen. We've got to move this on forward. Thank you.
Now, I just have two requests for each of y'all. I don't think that you'll find either one of them too difficult. First one is, I want you to go and do some campaigning for Karen and Kay this weekend. And if you can't knock on doors, then make phone calls. And if you can't make phone calls, then tell somebody about voting, bring somebody a yard sign, take somebody to the poll, even if it's just on Facebook. Please, please spend some of your time this afternoon working to elect these two great women.
The other thing that I want to ask you to do before you leave here this morning is look around the room for the people that you don't know, especially if you are a regular and have been coming here for a long time. Look for folks who are new and introduce yourselves and make them feel welcome, because folks, that is how we are going to grow this party, continue to grow the party, and bring in great new people into the organization who are eager to get involved. And having friendly faces reach out and talk to them and make them feel welcome goes a really, really long way. So I encourage everybody, please meet your neighbors and your friends in this room and make people feel welcome. And that is all. No? Okay. I was going to turn it over to Trey, but he says he's done. So thank y'all so much. Thanks again to our candidates, and have a great day.
I'm going to say,